Well, thank you, and good evening to our concert celebrating and honoring the 200th anniversary of the birth of the Star-Spangled Banner. The words and music that celebrate the red, white, and blue of our country's flag. My thanks to the members of the Maryland National Guard for the presentation of the colors this evening. Nice big hand for those. This military honor guard serves our Maryland veterans by performing over 300 military funerals for our departed comrades every month. So they are very busy, and we were honored to have them present the colors this evening. Now, the Star-Spangled Banner, that's why we're here this evening. The poem that was born on September 13 to 14, 1814, during the Battle of Fort McHenry, and written by a Maryland lawyer from Frederick by the name of Francis Scott Key. Key was on board a British warship that evening, seeking the release of a Dr. Bean, who had been imprisoned since the Battle of Bladensburg. Though successful, he had to remain on the ship until the British finished off the fort and invaded Baltimore, intent on burning it like they did in Washington, D.C. just earlier. Well, we know that was not to be, of course. And as the sun rose and Key saw the flag was there, it inspired him to write those stirring words we know today as our national anthem. And Maryland played an important part in the birth and the subsequent adoption of the song as our national anthem. Now, as we progress in tonight's concert, you will hear the Star-Spangled Banner, our national anthem, in many forms and settings. Now, protocol requires you to stand every time you hear the music. But for tonight, let's put that aside, okay, so that you can enjoy this wonderful music. Otherwise, you'd be hopping up and down every few minutes. So, now, moving on to our next piece. If there was any American composer wrapped up in the American flag and patriotism, it certainly was George M. Cohan. Born on the 3rd of July, he liked to fudge it by a bit by a day, so he could always claim to be that Yankee Doodle boy born on the 4th of July. And his music exuded America. A great Broadway composer, his music set the tone for musical theater and gave America great songs to sing about and ideas to cheer about. In this medley of songs, four Cohan songs, you will hear Give My Regards to Broadway, I'm a Yankee Doodle Dandy, Over There, and Grand Old Flag. This is our four Cohan songs. Boy, that gets the blood going, doesn't it? Great George M. Cohan stuff. Well, many marches use patriotic medleys in the composition, and this piece, our next piece by Bagley, is no exception. This march, National Emblem, was written in 1902, and it remains one of the best known and most popular marches written. It's a perfect combination with a magnificent march style writing and musical quotes from the Star-Spangled Banner. In the first strain, you'll hear in the low brass the Star-Spangled Banner being played. And it gives it a real patriotic flavor. To conduct this march is Captain Rick Barnes. And Captain Barnes started his military career as a trumpeter with the United States Academy Band at West Point, and then played with the United States Army Field Band right down the road at Fort Meade. He then got a commission and worked in the U.S. Army music program and retired from that program, but continues to serve the Maryland Defense Force. He is one of our strongest advocates in the use of state defense forces in the country. So I'd like to bring up Captain Rick Barnes to conduct the National Emblem March. Thank you, Captain Barnes. Another big hand for Rick Barnes, our conductor. Rick not only plays the bass, but he also serves as our public affairs officer. So if you have any questions about the band, he's the guy to talk to. And if you're interested in donning one of these uniforms, we have Major Fisher's back in the percussion section. He is the recruiter for the MDDF band, and we'll tell you a little bit more about what we do and everything before this evening is over. But he's the guy to talk to in case you're interested in wanting to serve the state of Maryland. So, our national anthem. Well, where did the tune come from? Well, here's a little history on the song, which started life as a tune called To Anacreon in Heaven. Now, everyone thinks, oh, it was a British drinking song that came over to the United States. And, well, that's not quite true. The tune really originates in London, at a social club for gentlemen who met every other week for formal concerts, dinner, and social time, which included singing catches and glees and amusing little songs. And this is back in, of course, in the 1700s. The founder of this organization, this Anacreon Club, was a fellow by the name of Ralph Thompson, and he wrote a piece of music, or actually he wrote a poem that was set to some music for the club by a church organist and composer by the name of John Stafford Smith. Smith was not a member of the club, but he was hired to write this the melody that would go with these words. And the words celebrated the Greek poet Anacreon. And of course the society was named in his honor. Now the words go, and you have to try to forgive my terrible voice here, but the original words to this poem was, To Anacreon in heaven, where he sat in full glee, a few sons of harmony set a petition that he their inspire and patron should be. When this answer arrived from that jolly old Grecian, voice, fiddle, and flute, no longer be mute. I'll lend you my name and inspire you to boot. And besides, I'll instruct you, like me, to entwine the myrtle of Venus and Bacchus vine. Talks about drinking and having a good time and stuff. And that was the original poem that was set to this music by John Stafford Smith. Now, many words were added, and the song made its way to the colonies. In fact, there were dozens of new lyrics set to this tune. It became a very popular tune in colonial America. In fact, a new version of it came in praise of our second president, a tune called Adams and Liberty. Now, that Francis Scott Key chose the melody for his poem that he composed during the Battle of Fort McHenry is questionable because he probably knew the tune and fitted his own new poem, his new text, to that melody. Now, after Key wrote the poem, the music appeared in a Baltimore publisher store and soon was played by instrumental groups. It was not only sung, but also played by small groups. And the earliest version we have of an instrumental version comes from our good friends at the Library of Congress. And this dates from 1832, and it was scored for the wind bands of the late 19th and early 19th century bands like they had at West Point. Now these bands were not the full concert bands like you see before you today. Rather, these were small ensembles originally started in Europe called oboe bands, but also called harmony music, which were the military bands at the time. And they consisted of woodwinds. If anyone's ever familiar, if you've ever heard of Handel's fireworks music with the oboes and the French horns and stuff, that's the type of bands it was written for. Now, this piece of music that we have today was written for, we have two flute players who play this. It was written for two clarinets. We have an oboe who plays it, bassoon, two horns. Now, interestingly enough, back then it was natural horns, which didn't have all that great tubing up there. And it was also scored for the sax horn. Well, we don't have a sax horn, so we've asked our bass clarinetist to play it. Thank you, guys. So what you're gonna hear is the earliest version of the Star-Spangled Banner. Now, it's gonna sound like there's a wrong note in the music. In fact, if I could ask an oboe player just to play a little bit of it, you're gonna say, oh, there's a wrong note. It sounds like a wrong note there. Well, that's how it was originally written. And of course it was fixed, of course, as it went on. But here we go with the earliest version written for the small woodwind ensemble back in 1832. And like I said, thanks to our friends at the Library of Congress for giving us this early manuscript. And like I said, you don't need to stand up, just enjoy this terrific version, early version of the Star-Spangled Banner. Thank you, members of our woodwind ensemble. The Defense Force Band does break down into smaller groups. The Army calls them MPTs, music performance teams. And we go out and we do performances as a woodwind group, or we might send a brass group out or drummers to play at a parade. That way we get a chance to go out into the community and play as much as possible. Our next piece of music is Festival Overture on a National Air. And in 1879, one of America's leading American composers, a fellow by the name of Dudley Buck, who's probably a name that's often neglected today, unfortunately, he wrote a festival overture to celebrate Independence Day. Now, the 7-minute piece was scored for full orchestra with optional chorus and was based on the melody of the Star-Spangled Banner, or what the composer called the American National Air. And we have to remember that before 1931, this was not our national anthem. It was a patriotic song in the same way like God Bless America today is, or This Land Is My Land, something like that. It's a a nice patriotic song to sing. It wasn't considered our anthem. Now, just about a decade before he wrote this work, Dudley Buck had composed a very popular solo organ work, his concert variations on the Star-Spangled Banner. It was a very popular piece. If you are familiar with the Brahms Academic Festival Overture that uses school songs like Gaudeamus Igitur, then you'll know how this next piece is going to sound. The festival overture uses the theme of the Star-Spangled Banner and weaves its way through the many variations and musical molds until it climaxes with a stirring rendition of the Star-Spangled Banner. Now, this will be your opportunity to stand up and sing the Star-Spangled Banner, just as they did back in the 1880s. You'll hear about 6 minutes of great symphonic music, and then it leads up to this real great stirring version, and I'll turn around and conduct you in the Star-Spangled Banner. I don't think we need to go over the words. I think everybody knows it, okay? So here is Dudley Buck's Festival Overture on an American National Air, the Star-Spangled Banner. Now that gets the blood going, doesn't it? Yeah. Can you imagine with the huge chorus back in the 1880s and everyone singing along? Just wonderful. Now, as the 19th century went on, the United States, of course, had no official national anthem. During the Civil War, the Star-Spangled Banner was used as a national air, along with Hail Columbia, Yankee Doodle, and Columbia Gem of the Ocean. In 1889, the Secretary of the Navy designated that the Star-Spangled Banner be played at the raising of the American flag. And it was around this time that John Philip Sousa, the great American composer and bandmaster, arranged the tune of the anthem in a collection of world national anthems and airs to be used at official government functions. Although there is some indication that Sousa favored Hail Columbia as our national anthem, he became a strong supporter of the Star-Spangled Banner, and he lived long enough to see it become our official national anthem in 1931. Now, the adoption of the Star-Spangled Banner as our national anthem is in large part due to the hard work of a Maryland congressman from this area, a man by the name of John Charles Lithicum. He spent 12 years trying to convince members of Congress to enact legislation making the Star-Spangled Banner our national anthem. But it took up till 1916 for President Woodrow Wilson to actually sign the executive order formally designating the anthem status. Now, all that remained after that was for Congress to pass an act confirming President Wilson's order, and then for Herbert Hoover to sign it. And the Star-Spangled Banner, of course, as I said, had the strong support of John Philip Sousa, who opined that besides Key's soul-stirring words, it is the spirit of the music that inspires. On March 3rd, 1931, President Herbert Hoover signed the act establishing Key's poem and John Smith's music as the official anthem of the United States. And it beat out all other pieces of music that were vying to become, vying for the honor of becoming the song associated with our country. And so we would like to play for you three also-rans. These are pieces that were at one time considered, under consideration for being our national anthem. The first one is Hail Columbia, which actually dates back almost to the Revolutionary War period. Tune Red, White, and Blue, which is also known as Columbia, Gem of the Ocean, and Yankee Doodle. All these three arrangements were arranged by John Philip Sousa. And one thing about Hail Columbia, even though it did not become our national anthem, Hail Columbia is actually used as an honors piece of music. When you hear the President of the United States enter a room, you hear, of course, Hail to the Chief. Well, Hail Columbia today is used for the entrance of the Vice President. So here are these three pieces, all arranged by John Philip Sousa. Thank you. Thank you. Can you imagine any one of those three tunes as being our national anthem? It might be a little difficult to think that, you know, in 2014, but at the turn of the century, in the 1890s, those songs were under consideration. It's a good thing that General Grant didn't choose one because he was tone deaf. General Grant, great Civil War general and president, had always said that he only knew two tunes. One was Yankee Doodle and the other wasn't. Now, speaking of the Civil War, we're going to play a Civil War instrumental version of the Star-Spangled Banner. And this was arranged by Claudio Grifola. And Claudio Grifola was an Italian composer who came to the United States. He is considered to be like the John Philip Sousa of the Civil War era. Wrote an incredible amount of music. And one of the pieces he did arrange was a setting of the Star-Spangled Banner. And this, of course, during the Civil War, the song was found in virtually every band book in the Union Army. And you'll notice when you hear this piece, it might sound like a waltz to you, but that was the style of the time. And the last chorus is repeated, which was very typical in the 19th century. And the key is a little different. It'll sound a little higher if you try to sing along to it. And it has a very distinct flavor to it, as it was this type of arrangement used by Civil War bands. We don't have Civil War instruments today, so we're going to play them on modern instruments, but we will play it in the same key. Now, the arrangement by Claudio Grifola was reportedly played by a band on April 14th, 1865, at the ceremony marking the raising of the U.S. flag at Fort Sumter, South Carolina, 4 years after the flag had been hauled down. So we're going to go back, take your minds back to 1865. This is what the crowd at Fort Sumter would have heard. I almost forgot to mention, too, it has a little bit of a flourish in the high cornet part. So a little unusual, but I think you'll enjoy it. Unique sound to the Star-Spangled Banner. Well, thank you so much for listening to our concert so far, and to end the first half of our program, we'd like to close by honoring those men and women who protect our Star-Spangled Banner every day with their service to our nation, and also those who have worn the uniform. Thanks for your service. So to all those who've served in the Army, Marines, Navy, Air Force and Coast Guard, we are proud to present your service song. Thank you so much. We're going to take a 10-minute intermission, and then we'll be back with some more music celebrating and commemorating the 200th anniversary of the Star-Spangled Banner. The Maryland Defense Force is always eager to get new recruits, and the band is no different. We're always looking for good musicians to join our organization, and we've been together now for over 5 years, and the band has performed concerts throughout the state of Maryland. We've done ceremonies down in Annapolis. We've played for the governor. We've just done a little bit of everything, and we've got some upcoming concerts that are going to be very unique and very high profile for us. For example, on September 11th, the band is going to play a ceremony at Patterson Park. We have members of the 175th Infantry, Maryland National Guard, who are going to retrace the same route that the Maryland Militia did 200 years ago on September 11th, as they left the camp in Patterson Park and marched down to North Point. So on September 11th, we're going to recreate that. The band's going to play a ceremony as the troops march out, a 6-mile trip for the troops down to Battle Acre, which is on Old North Point Road. Then on September 13th at Fort McHenry, the band is playing a 2:00 concert in the afternoon, the day, the big commemoration. There'll be fireworks that night at the fort and a lot of musical activities. And then the band is going to play this concert again on September 20th at North County High School in Glen Burnie. So if you get a chance, come down and hear that concert. Now, one of the great things I get to do as commander is not only award people medals and ribbons for the great work that they do, and also get to promote people, but I also get to enlist them for a period of time. And we have a brand new recruit, a clarinet player, who's come to us, a graduate of Towson. Found out about the band. She works down at Rosso's Music Store, and we were able to grab her and get her into the to our band. We haven't got her a uniform yet. That's the next thing on our agenda. You know, we're all volunteers, so we don't have uniforms issued to us. We buy our own uniforms, so we're in the process of doing that. But we're going to do something a little military right now, and we're going to enlist. Give the oath of enlistment to Ashley C., our clarinet player. So Ashley, why don't you join me up here? Attention to orders. Oh boy. You nervous?
Yes.
Okay. Raise your right hand. Repeat after me. I do solemnly swear that I will bear true faith and allegiance.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance
to the United States of America.
To the United States of America.
And to the state of Maryland.
And to the state of Maryland.
That I will serve them honestly.
That I will serve them honestly.
And faithfully.
And faithfully.
Against all enemies whosoever.
Against all enemies whosoever.
And that I will obey the orders of the President of the United States.
And that I will bear orders the President of the United States.
And the governor of the state of Maryland.
And the governor of the state of Maryland.
And the orders of the officers appointed over me.
And the orders of the officers appointed over me.
According to law and regulations.
According to law and regulations.
Congratulations. Ashley is enlisted as a staff sergeant in the band, so we're glad to have you, and we hope that you bring us, you know, great stuff and do us proud as you serve as a clarinet player and a volunteer in the state of Maryland. Our next piece of music is called Daughters of the American Revolution, and this piece was written in 1910 and dedicated to that organization. It was written by a fellow by the name of Jens Bodvalt Lampe, originally from Norway, and Lampe was probably a very prolific composer and probably had more influence over the music of the 1900s and the 1910s as an arranger of music as he did in his capacity as a composer. And some of his arrangements of classical melodies into songs help keep music alive well into this century. He wrote also a lot of piano music, and the next piece we're going to play for you originally started life as a piano sheet music from Tin Pan Alley. And the Daughters of the American Revolution March uses patriotic songs associated with the Daughters, including Hail Columbia, Yankee Doodle, Dixie, The Girl I Left Behind Me, and also one song that was under consideration as our anthem, albeit for a short period of time, and that song was My Country, 'Tis of Thee. And the melody, of course, is of the God Save the Queen, the anthem of the United Kingdom, so that's why we couldn't use it, because it was already taken. I think you'll enjoy this. The arrangement was done by the then commander, newly appointed commander of the U.S. Navy Band. And here we go with Daughters of the American Revolution. Thank you. one song that may have or should have made it as our anthem was the great tune, America the Beautiful. The lyrics were written by Catherine Lee Bates, and the music was composed by a church organist and choir master, Samuel A. Ward. Bates originally wrote the words as a poem called Pike's Peak, first published in the 4th of July edition of a church periodical called The Congregationalist in 1895. And at that time, the poem was just entitled, you know, America for publication, and Ward had originally written the music earlier, the hymn called O Mother Dear Jerusalem in 1882. When it was put together, it became the great piece we know today, of course, as America the Beautiful. Now, at various times since the song was written, particularly during the Kennedy administration, there have been efforts to give America the Beautiful. I'm a bugler, so I guess that's always on my mind. There have been efforts to give America the Beautiful legal status, either as a national hymn or as a national anthem equal to or in place of the Star-Spangled Banner, but so far this has not succeeded. Proponents prefer America the Beautiful for many reasons, saying it's easier to sing, more melodic, and more adaptable to new orchestrations while remaining as easily recognizable as the Star-Spangled Banner. So the efforts have been, you know, stymied, changing the tradition, but America the Beautiful continues to be held in high esteem by a large number of Americans. The setting we're about to play for you is just the setting of the America the Beautiful, the most gorgeous one to be found. And it was scored by the great orchestrator and conductor, Carmen Dragon. This is America the Beautiful.
Thank you.
Well, you are all here for a world premiere, a piece of music that has not been performed in over 80 years. And I say it's a world premiere in that this piece that we're going to play for you never existed in a band arrangement. It actually existed in a theater type of arrangement. Ferdy Groffé, the composer of this next piece, Ode to the Star-Spangled Banner, was a prolific American composer. He was actually a jazz pianist, played for the Paul Whiteman Orchestra. His big claim to fame, there are actually two of them. He scored the music for Rhapsody in Blue. He was the orchestrator, worked with George Gershwin in doing the orchestrations for Rhapsody in Blue. And then he wrote a number of symphonic pieces, and I think the most famous one of those was a piece called the Grand Canyon Suite. I think everybody who's grown up in public schools got to hear a little bit of the Grand Canyon Suite. And you can't go to the South Rim without, you know, hearing that music in your head. Well, Groffé also wrote a lot of theater music and a lot of music for radio. And he was asked to put together a sort of tone poem commemorating the Battle of Baltimore. And what he came up with was this Ode to the Star-Spangled Banner. Now, after it was performed, the manuscript went to the Library of Congress, where it stayed for about 80 years. Last year, a friend of mine by the name of Neil Grauer, who works up at Hopkins University, became very interested in digging up this piece of music. Went down to the library, talked to the librarians, and they were able to find the original manuscript. It was brought to me for editing and to make a transcription of it for full symphonic orchestra. And while I was doing that, I said, well, gee, I might as well do one for band also. And we had some conversations with Ferdy Groffé's son, Ferdy Groffé Jr., who is still alive and is very aware of his father's works. And he was very supportive in this project. Now, the symphonic version is going to be performed by the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra in their big celebration of the Star-Spangled Banner on September 20th. That's the same night that we're doing our big concert down at North County High School. So I don't want you to, you know, you should come down and hear us play it, okay? Even though they're gonna sound great, but come down and hear us. Anyway, so what you're gonna hear in this piece of music is, once again, variations on the Star-Spangled Banner. You're going to hear the quote of the anthem as it starts, and then it goes into the Battle of Baltimore with some very colorful type of music going on, depicting the battle. And it'll finally end up with the percussion doing the bombs bursting, the bass drum playing the bombs. We'll hear a whistle as the rockets red glare and all that good stuff. And then it'll end up with a version of the Star-Spangled Banner. And it's very interesting that Groffé arranged this with his musical ear, his own harmonic language. So it'll sound a little different than what you're used to hearing. Okay, this is the world premiere of a piece called Ode to the Star-Spangled Banner by Ferdy Groffé.
Thank you.
So the musical depiction of the Battle of Fort McHenry, the Battle of Baltimore, my goodness. Wow, okay. God Bless America. This is another piece that has always been under consideration for as being our second national anthem. And this piece was written by Irving Berlin way back in 1918. It was written for a show and then put into the drawer for a while. And it wasn't until 1938 that he revised it. And then during the 1940s, during the middle of World War II, it was made popular, and by the recording made by Kate Smith, became her signature song. And of course, the song itself takes form of a prayer. While the storm clouds gather far across the sea, let us swear allegiance to a land that's free. Let us all be grateful for a land so fair as we raise our voices in a solemn prayer. And God bless America. So I will invite you, if you'd like, to stand up and sing along when we get to the refrain. We're gonna play the chorus to it, and you'll know when to come in and sing along. Star-Spangled Banner, of course, it's a flag, and music has been written throughout the years to celebrate it, to honor it, to revere it. In his autobiography called Marching Along, John Philip Sousa wrote that he composed the Stars and Stripes Forever on his way home from a vacation with his wife in Europe, and he had just learned of the recent death of David Blakely, who was the manager of the Sousa Band. And he said that he composed the march in his head and committed the notes to paper on arrival in the United States. Now, while pacing the deck of the ship in the moonlight, he said that the music of the Stars and Stripes Forever came to him. And I'm sure, of course, that the US flag was fluttering in the breeze. He said, quote, "Absorbed in the thoughts of my manager's death and the many duties and decisions which awaited me in New York, suddenly I began to sense a rhythmic beat of a band playing within my brain. Throughout the whole tense voyage, that imaginary band continued to unfold the same themes echoing and re-echoing the most distant melody. When he got to New York, of course, he wrote those notes down and they became the famous march, The Stars and Stripes Forever. By a 1987 act of the United States Congress, it became our official national march of the United States. Even Sousa had words that he thought that would go appropriate with it. Let martial note in triumph float, and liberty extend its mighty hand. A flag appears mid thunderous cheers, the banner of the Western land. The Stars and Stripes Forever by John Philip Sousa.
Thank you.
we've come to the close of our musical journey this evening with that tune that started with a glee club back in London, that Gentleman's Society, to the text written by Francis Scott Key. Of course, that patriotic song that was born here in Baltimore 200 years ago during a terrific strife. That song continued on through the Mexican War, the Civil War, the Spanish-American War, World War I, and on to its adoption in 1931 as our national anthem. It is indeed the one piece of music that unites every single American under one flag. Hope you've enjoyed this concert tonight, and on behalf of the Adjutant General for the State of Maryland, Major General James A. Atkins, the Commander of the Maryland Defense Force, Brian R. Kelm, and the men and women of the Maryland Defense Force Band, we thank you so much for attending this evening, and we hope that you've enjoyed what we had to present for you. Thank you, you're so kind, thank you. As we do with every single concert, we're gonna close with our service song. Yes, we have our own service song, and that is My Maryland. This is a march that was written around the turn of the century, and we'll end up with, of course, our state song, which is Maryland, My Maryland. Once again, thank you for having us on behalf of the men and women of the Maryland Defense Force Band. And we'd like to thank Lerman Theater for having us this evening, and we'd like to close with My Maryland. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a big hand for the Maryland Defense Force Band.